a canonical form for tensor networks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. That's the title of my talk, but essentially I think the best description would be exactly how to use the talk of Michael Walter for the talk of Norbert Schuch. And indeed, probably if you paid attention to both of them, I should just leave as an exercise my talk. So essentially, and we could just go. Because that's more or less what we are going to do. There you have the archive paper where you can find all the details. And okay, these are the authors, which is essentially a collaboration between Bochum and Madrid. Probably everyone is in different places now, but okay, essentially this is how it started. That's more or less what my plan for the talk. First, I will introduce a bit again tensor networks. It was introduced yesterday by Guillaume, today by Norbert. So I will go a bit fast, but this simply just to fix the notation for the talk. I will also devote a bit of time to show how those objects look innocent, but they are not. And indeed, there has been already several ideas in that direction, but I think maybe I would like to point that again. I will explicitly make the questions that I would like to address, which essentially have appeared again in the talk of Norbert and the talk of Michael, which are about fundamental theorems and canonical forms. And already Norbert made a big a motivation for why those things are interesting. Then, so essentially point two is essentially repeating a bit Norbert's talk, but again, from a bit of a, okay, essentially repeating Norbert's talk, but the condensed way. And three would be essentially the why geometric invariant theory, which is the talk of Michael, is natural here, which essentially would be like repeating Michael's talk, but again, everything very condensed. And then we'll focus on the results, essentially how to use 3 for 2, which is, as I said, how to use the talk of Michael for the talk of Norbert. And time permitting, I will sketch a nice application of these type of things to something different, which is something which is not the usual applications we have in mind, or we had in mind, people working in tensor networks with a motivation for quantum matter. And also connects with the talk of Guillaume yesterday on how tensor networks have been used also in the context of machine learning. Okay, so that's more or less the idea. Okay, so let me start, tensor networks. Let me start with a rank for tensor. And a rank for tensor, there are many ways in which you can see it. In my case, I would like to see this as an element in the tensor product of the endomorphisms of some complex vector space, so I mentioned the small d tensor endomorphism of some complex vector space of dimension capital D, which of course is the same as a linear map from CD tensor CD into CD tensor CD, one small one capital. With the graphical notation that have been already introduced in the talks of Guillaume and Norbert, we can see this as just a box or a circle or something with a label, which is as the name of the tensor, and then legs, which correspond to the different tensor elements in the tensor product, and here I will add arrows simply because I would like to see this as a linear map. Arrows pointing in means the input of the map. Arrows pointing out means the output of the map. And okay, these two arrows means tensor product, of course. So I think that's more or less clear. So then with those things, we can do this sort of tensor train construction in which somehow what we do is whenever we put the same element, the same tensor one next to the other, this is tensor product. But then what I do is in one of the two indices, let's say in capital D, I use the fact that they have endomorphisms and therefore I can multiply things, I can compose. And this is what I do. I mean, they compose these arrows, no? The output of one tensor goes into the input of the next, and so on and so forth. While, and this happens for the capital D, for the horizontal direction, whereas for the vertical directions, nothing happens, and therefore what I have is just tensor products. Okay, so this object will be in the endomorphisms of C of small d tensor L times with itself. Okay, and this is what we call a one-dimensional tensor network. And in this case, we'll call a matrix product operator, because again, I see as an operator from the above to the below. We can put boundary conditions. For instance, again, this is in the horizontal arrow. These are endomorphisms. So I can plug an initial vector and end with a final functional on this dimension. And then this object leaves, or I can do a trace, which is simply just when I have a final, I mean, just joining these arrows, no? Making the output, the input of the same object, the trace. And okay, one can even make formulas with that, but I will not use them because they are a bit cumbersome. But as I say, this object is an element that goes from CD tensor L into itself, so it's an endomorphism. And if this E sub IJ, which are the matrix elements, so essentially the canonical basis of the matrices, one in position IJ, zero in the rest, then I can expand. And this is just a basis of the tensor product of the vertical legs. Simply it's a basis of the endomorphisms of CD tensor L. And then the corresponding coefficient is just simply taking a matrix A, IJ, multiply with the next matrix and so on, because it's just composition and taking the trace in the end. Okay, so that's the notation that we have seen already a couple of times. So these objects look innocent, but they are not. And I will also like to comment other places in which these objects appear. And one thing is, I think one can see this very, very easily, is in the study of information transmission. In particular, about channels with memory. Everything is classical, that's in quantum here. So a classical channel with memory, with a finite memory, I can see as a tensor in which the vertical direction I interpret as the input-output dimension of the channel, and the horizontal is the memory input-output. And all I ask is that this object from input to output is a stochastic map. And then this object here is, if I initialize the memory in a state V, this is just L uses of a classical channel with finite memory. So first use, second use, and so on and so forth. In the context of channels with memory, one can also talk about the capacity, the information capacity of a channel. And this operationally, one can define exactly the same way as in the memoryless case. It's just the optimal rate of bits per use of the channel that can be transmitted in a way that the error of the transmission goes to zero. And there are general coding theorems, but in this case, in general, the capacity is not the optimized mutual information rate, but there are families of channels for which this is the case. They are especially nice and they are called information stable. And then the question is if one can compute or even approximate the capacity of an information stable channel. So even if there is a nice coding theorem, and the answer is no in the most dramatic way. And then, okay, we saw some years ago that this is even approximating the capacity to a finite precision is undecidable in the sense that there does not exist any computable function that can approximate the capacity to precision 1/5 essentially the maximum possible capacity is one because the output is just one bit. Okay, and okay, there are just number of inputs, memory for which we know how to prove that. So essentially these objects that look very innocent, they encode easily already very hard, extremely hard problems, even uncomputable problems. In a different direction, and that's exactly connects with the talk of Norbert, if you come from quantum many-body systems, essentially the way in which these objects appear is if we ask them to be quantum states. And a quantum state is nothing but a matrix, or a linear operator, which is semi-definite positive and has trace one. And when this happens, we instead of talking about operator, we say density operator, just to say that is a state. And then Norbert already said that they approximate well the low energy sector, meaning thermal and ground states of local interacting quantum systems in one dimension, essentially. And indeed, this was the origin of studying those objects in a couple of papers in 1992, independent ones by Steve White and by Fannes Master and Amber. Okay, so the theorem, or one of the theorems I state a version in this last paper of Suchan Verstate in 2017, but this goes back via a series of different authors to the work of Hastings in 2006, is that if we want to approximate, sorry, to estimate the observable, the expectation value of an observable that acts on L sites on this state, and we are able to tolerate a precision, so an error epsilon, then the capital D, which is called, what is called usually the bond dimension, scales like L over epsilon. And that's the result. So essentially, this means that these quantities, which are the quantities that one is interesting to estimate, because this is the one that one can really measure in a lab, are well approximated by those objects. Okay, and they appear depending on the context. For instance, if we ask these objects to be unitary operators, then we recover traditional invariant quantum pseudo automata, and then one can somehow reinterpret very easily in this context the index theorem. And as I maybe comment at the end of the talk, and it was again commented yesterday, they are also alternative architectures for machine learning processes. So this more or less to motivate the objects and to show that, okay, questions, even if the objects look easy, don't need to be easy. So there are kind of two basic questions that essentially were very well explained in Norbert's talk. And question one is related to what Norbert talked, the fundamental question. If we have two different tensors, let me put them green and orange, we would like to know when the MPOs, the matrix product operators they define, are equal or not for all L or for fixed L or whatever. That's the question. When is this the case? And second question, which is the canonical form question, is if we are given a given tensor, green one, and we consider all other tensors, orange ones, that give the same matrix product operators, can we find among those one which is good, so a good representative, what we call a canonical form, and good, of course, in some sense that I will specify later. So these are the two types of questions that we can call as fundamental theorem questions and canonical form questions. And both questions are a priori related. And indeed, for that, we will show this result, which is okay, we call the fundamental theorem of matrix product vectors in the form of this paper of 2017, which is the strongest form. And as opposed to the talk of Norbert or the results he showed, in which one assumed hypotheses like normality, injectivity, there are no hypotheses here. And then the result is that there exists an efficient map that associated to each tensor, convert it into another tensor, which we call canonical form. So that, of course, both the green and the canonical form green give rise to the same matrix product operator, of course. But also, if we compare two tensors, both in canonical form, that give rise to the same matrix product operator, the only possibility, so if and only if, is that they are related by a unitary transformation on the, what is called this virtual degree of freedom, the one about the capital D. And it's important that this is unitary. And for many applications, this is very important. Okay, so that's, in a sense, we have a fundamental theorem, but with good properties, essentially unitary conjugations, only if before we convert the tensors into canonical forms. Okay, and that's the way the two things mix. Okay, it's called fundamental theorem by a reason, and okay, Norbert's talk was devoted to that. But let me just sketch some of the applications of this result. So as we saw in the talk of Norbert, they allow to classify one-dimensional quantum phases of matter under global symmetries, these SPT phases. But also in the context of normal topological order, they make the classifying object, which is fusion categories, emerge naturally in two dimensions from normalization fixed point conditions. They also allow to recover, as I said before, the index of 1D quantum pseudo automata just from understanding the flattening ranks of the tensor. They allow, I will comment on that at the end, to design privacy-preserving machine learning protocols. And that's more like theoretical applications. And one of the most important one is numerical. And is the fact that if you use those objects numerically as a numerical variational ansatz to optimize a function, essentially the energy of a Hamiltonian or something like that. If you work in canonical form, then the algorithms are stable. And if you don't, sometimes they are not. So it's okay. And there are others, but that's those that I consider more maybe interesting or illustrative. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, so let's dig a bit more into question one. Question one is this fundamental theorem question. Okay, essentially, when can we say that two MPOs defined by different tensors are equal? We said, we saw in our talk, there is a clear sufficient condition, which is when they are somehow related by a, what is called a gauge transformation. It's just simply a conjugation by a invertible matrix Y. This invertible matrix Y is called a gauge transformation. And the question is whether it's necessary or not. And okay, it's not necessary. And there are, I can give you just one example. So if I take an orange tensor, in the vertical direction, I just consider the matrices which have one, the matrices have a one in the position 0, 0, and 0 and the rest, and E11 is the one that has a one in position 11 and 0 the rest. So essentially it's the two elements in the diagonal. And V refers to the vertical direction. And then I have a sum, and at the other side of the tensor, together with the E00, I have this matrix, and this is the matrix that reflects the endomorphism in the horizontal direction. And associated to this E11, I have this other matrix. Okay? And the green is exactly the same, but we change the m's with the m hats, and it's essentially removing the off-diagonal terms from the m's. So this is very similar to this example of Jordan matrices in the talk of Michael Walter, but now when we have more than one matrix, we have two matrices together. I mean, it's a kind of a vector of two matrices. Okay, that's the example, and it's easy to see that that they define the same matrix product operator, and the reason is whatever happens in the upper corner is totally irrelevant for the matrix product operator because I will just do multiplications and traces and this will never appear. However, there is no way to relate by a gauge transformation the green from the orange. Okay? So essentially, this shows that this sufficient condition is not necessary. However, again, similar to Michael's talk, this is almost true. I mean, the green and the orange are almost equal up to a gauge. And all I have to do is to allow myself to take limits. So now if I take a sequence of invertible matrices and in which I have just of this form epsilon 0, 0, 1, and I make epsilon go to 0, then after the limit, the two things are equal. Okay, and this solves this example, and again, by taking limits. And the idea is that the same solves all examples. Yes, if we allow ourselves to take limits, essentially, this is all that can happen. No? And this very basic observation, especially from an audience that is very familiar to geometric invariant theory, at least for me, was a big discovery. Because somehow there is a theory in which taking disclosures is very natural. And if you allow yourself to take disclosures, taking limits, then suddenly many things becomes way easier. And that's more or less what we will do. And then, of course, in order to do that, we have to talk about axioms of Lie groups and orbits. And in this case, it's totally clear which is the Lie group, which is the axion, and which is the orbit. So we have a tensor. We have the axion of the Lie group, the general linear group associated to the dimension of the horizontal leg. And we act by conjugation. We consider the orbit, and I will denote it by this theta of t. And we take closures. So now we define two tensors to be gauge related. The intersection of the closures of the orbits is not empty. Essentially, if I can arrive to a tensor coming for either of the two orbits by taking limits. We can restate in this language a well-known result on geometric invariant theory joining several results from the 70s and the 80s, so that now we can rephrase it in this language. And it says that two tensors are gauge related if and only if they define the same matrix product operator for all sizes from 1 to d squared. And this can be improved to order d log d using more recent results. And of course, this is also equivalent if we take the same thing for all L. Okay, so essentially allowing ourselves to take closures, we have a perfect fundamental theorem. I mean, that is valid for all tensors. And that's a big difference somehow with the result that Norbert presented, in which somehow he needed to assume a hypothesis, normality, injectivity. Here the result is true without any hypothesis. Okay, but of course the price to pay is that you have to take limits in the orbits. Essentially, this shows that this GIT perspective is very powerful because it gives, interesting results with an elegant proof. Let's see what this GIT add to the second type of questions. So about canonical forms. And again, we have the action of GL by conjugation. And now, in order to get interesting applications, as those that I sketch as an application of fundamental theorem together with canonical form. So we need a canonical form with good properties. First of all, is that the canonical form should belong to the orbit of to the closure of the orbit, so that of course it gives the same matrix product operator as the original tensor. We need it to be efficiently computable, and we need it to be uniquely defined. But it's okay if it's uniquely defined up to unitary gauges, because this exactly means that this canonical form gives exactly the version of the fundamental theorem we are interested in, saying that if we work at the canonical form level, the only freedom is a unitary conjugation. So essentially, we are able to reduce the symmetry from GL to U. And this is very important because, of course, U is compact. And there are many things one can do in U. For instance, one can sample in U that one cannot sample in GL. One can, or at least not in a clear way, in a uniform way, let's say. If the freedom is in U, you know that essentially by changing the gauge, you will not change the condition number. However, if you allow to change the gauge with matrices, invertible matrices, you can destroy easily the condition number, and that explains the stability results. So essentially, that's crucial for many of the applications. Okay, so that's what we want. So let's see how one can get this. So as I said, this already exists for 1D. And essentially, this is a GIT perspective of the result I already showed here. Okay, simply that there is a different proof. So I work directly to two dimensions, but what we do in 2D applies also to 1D, 3D, I mean, to any D. So it's not 3D any, there is no dimension behind. So any questions so far? Okay, so that's the really interesting case. And why? Because of course, for 1D, there are already canonical forms with those properties which are work extremely well. People have implemented them and work with them all the time.
So what does 1D exactly actually? What does 1D mean?
1D, okay, this 1D, 2D, 3D is the lattice. I mean, I will just consider only regular lattices. And then 1D, 2D, 3D is the geometric dimension with the lattice leaves. So 1D is one line, 2D is a plane, a torus, and 3D is hypercubes, things like that.
So, but the example you did in the previous slides, that was 1D or 2D? This is what is this?
Okay, this is what we want to have in any D. So simply, this is kind of the what we expect to have or we want to have in any D. But thinking from GIT perspective, thinking about orbits, closure of orbits, and these things. But essentially, in 1D, this already exists.
Yeah.
However, in 2D and 3D, there is nothing like that. And this indeed, in many papers, in many numerical papers, they try to get heuristic versions of canonical forms in order to get stable algorithms, because in 2D and 3D, this is a problem. Essentially, in 2D and 3D, there was before no canonical form. Though there were fundamental theorems. This is what Norbert showed, but no canonical form results. And I will go into that now.
Yeah.
Okay, so 2D tensor networks. So now instead of working with a rank 4 tensor, I will go with a rank 6 tensor. So I have 3 different directions. So the red one, which is the third direction, the one that goes out of the screen, is a small d, and for quantum medieval systems, this corresponds to the physical system. The other two, vertical and horizontal, is capital D and tilde capital D. They correspond to the virtual degrees of freedom. And then this object is just a tensor in the endomorphism of CD, tensor endomorphism of CD, tensor endomorphism of CD, tilde, so that essentially we make clear that in each one of the directions I can compose and multiply. To simplify the notation, this third dimensional arrow, the one of a small d, I will just represent as a dot, small dot, okay? Because otherwise the drawings are crazy. Okay, so now what I have is this type of thing. So I consider periodic boundary conditions, meaning that I take traces in all the endomorphisms, but I don't put the arrows again because the picture will become crazy. And then once I do that, the red dots are the only arrows which are still there. So this belongs to the endomorphism of C small d tensor, the size of the torus. Lambda is a torus because I take in periodic boundary conditions. And this is called a PEPO, projective entangled pair operator. And again, as in 1D, they approximate efficiently low energy sectors of local interacting Hamiltonians in 2 dimensions. But then, of course, in 2 dimensions, the Hamiltonians are way richer. You have topological order and many weird stuff. So things are necessarily more complicated here. Okay. Any question about the object I'm interested in? Again, I'm considering the traditional invariant case, so everything is defined from the same object, okay? Which is just this rank six tensor.
David, maybe one comment or question. So,
sure.
So it's not important in your talk, right, that this is that the remaining thing lives on an endomorphism space, right? You're not using the fact that it's an operator that comes out here.
No, indeed, I'm not using that. It can be just a vector, totally okay. I want to represent operators in order to cover usually thermal states or unitary operators. And of course, in particular, it includes pure states, but I agree that, I'm not using it at all. Good, so as already Norbert already commented, there is a problem to have simultaneously Q1 and Q2. And is the fact that deciding whether this final object is zero or not is undecidable, because simply one can encode tiling problems here. In particular, one can it's clear that if one encodes in this tensor a tiling problem, this object is zero if and only if the set of, for all L, if and only if the set of tiles doesn't allow a periodic tiling. And therefore, since deciding whether the set of tiles allows a periodic tiling is undecidable, this is undecidable. Okay, so there is a obstruction to get a general solution to both things. And here one can take 2 different paths. One is the one that Norbert took, which I will also comment on that, which is, okay, this, if one still wants to stay with tori, lambda, one is to add hypothesis here. But I will take a different approach, though I will connect with that later. So let's change the viewpoint. We consider 2 tensors, T and S. And the first step will be just to restrict to the case in which the tensors are already gauge related. And then within that property, look for a canonical form. Okay, so again, now, because there are more legs, we have the group that is acting is GL times GL, and it acts by simply conjugation. We consider orbits and we define 2 tensors to be gauge related if the intersection of the closures of the orbits is not empty. So as Norbert said already, this includes the case of generic tensor, what he called normal tensors. And the reason is, again, the result he showed that, okay, we proved it already long ago for lattices, though he showed the general case for graphs, is that 2 normal tensors define the same PEPO, the same for all tori, lambda, if and only if they are gauge related. So essentially, we know that if we restrict to normal tensors, this action of GL is the only characterizes the two tensors given the same PEPO, and therefore step one will allow us to obtain a canonical form for those cases. And then in a second step, we will analyze under which conditions can we guarantee that T and S must be gauge related. We know that it's not enough for general tensors so that they coincide, they define the same PEPO in all tori, but we will see which are the conditions that we can impose. And that's the second step, okay? So that's, but the goal is to get results that work for all possible tensors, okay? So we don't have to impose any hypothesis on the tensors, okay? So we want general results, not results for generic tensors as was the focus of the talk of Norbert. Any question about the... Okay, so let's go to step one. Step one is, let's assume that we only care about this gauge relation, and let's try to look for a canonical form. But of course, this is a problem about purely about geometric invariant theory. So we have a group action, orbits, we have this closure of orbits not empty, and in geometric invariant theory, it's very well known since it's Manford, that this is equivalent to the fact that for all invariant polynomials, the evaluation on T and S is exactly equal. So this suddenly gives rise to, you can work with polynomials, and that's very, very nice. So essentially that's a nice thing. And essentially what we do here is just apply the general results that Michael Walter showed for this particular example. And that's it, that's what we do. That's the minimal canonical form. So given a general tensor, arbitrary tensor, we define the canonical form as the tensor that minimizes the norm of all the tensors that live into the closure of the orbit. And okay, the norm is just the Hilbert norm. Since I'm considering looking at things as endomorphisms, the Hilbert norm is the Hilbert-Smith norm, but I mean, it's just the Hilbert norm. Okay, good. So, and now, exactly because of the previous talk by Michael, we know that it has all the properties we wanted, exactly the properties that we were looking for a canonical form. And those properties are just a consequence of known results and techniques in GIT, which are exactly those that Michael talked about in his talk. So property one, the minimal canonical form is unique up to unitary gauges. And that's exactly, this essentially a corollary of Kempner's result, which is essentially saying that the norm is geodesically log convex, and therefore being a minimum and being a critical point is the same thing. And together with the fact that, I mean, if I have two minimizers in the same orbit, they must be related by unitary. That's also part of the Kempner's theorem. And the Monfort theorem tells that, as I said, that closed orbits are characterized by polynomials. And therefore, if I have two closed orbits, either they are equal, either they are disjoint. And if they are disjoint, they can be separated by a invariant polynomial that can distinguish, I mean, can be different in one or in the other. So putting these two things together gives immediately property one as a corollary. So essentially it's a corollary of very classic all results in GIT. Property two is that it can be computed efficiently. And again, as Michael said, there are two options. One can do gradient descent or geodesically gradient descent. And this gives a running time which is polynomial in the bond dimensions and polynomial in 1 over epsilon. Or one can aim for a better scaling in the error, log 1 over epsilon, but one has to pay a price that the dependency on the bond dimension is exponential, or at least we don't have better bounds than exponential. So then, for instance, if you work with fixed bond dimension, fixed and small bond dimension, which is usually the case for people working in tensor networks, then the second order methods works extremely well for the error. But if not, or if you prefer to do something very easy like gradient descent, you still get very good convergence. And indeed, we are now collaborating with people doing numerics with tensor networks, and these gradient descent methods work extremely well, extremely fast to obtain the canonical form in each step, because the idea is there are algorithms of tensor networks which are known to be unstable. And then the idea is if in each step we recalculate the canonical form. So we put things back into canonical form. The idea is that things will be much more stable. And at least this subroutine of putting things back in canonical form is extremely fast. And it's just gradient descent. So we do first order methods. And it's the precision and time are, I mean, negligible compared to the rest of the algorithm. So that's very good. Okay, so, and then property three is that there is an algebraic formula which characterizes Vini minimal canonical form. And this is very useful to check if concrete tensors are already in canonical form. For instance, one can easily check that the toric code tensor is in canonical form, or any quantum double model tensor is in canonical form. I mean, many, many complex tensors are already in canonical form. This characterization is just, okay, take the geodesic gradient, equates it to zero, and this is just some algebraic thing. And that's exactly what characterizes being in minimal canonical form, because the thing we are minimizing is convex, or geodesically convex. So suddenly, somehow using all these type of results that Michael talked about in his talk, we immediately get a canonical form that is defined for every dimension, which was not known before, with the properties we were looking for, essentially. I wouldn't say for free, because of course there are things to be estimated. Especially in property two, as Michael said, one needs a priori estimates on the norms and so on and so forth, but essentially for free. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay, so now step two. We need to characterize being H related, but for general tensors. We know again that if the tensor is normal, being H related can be characterized as defining the same people in tori of larger and larger sizes. But what if we don't want to impose any hypothesis? So we have two tensors and we'd like to know when they are related, so when they are gauge equivalent. So in order to see how to characterize that, let's start with a tensor T. And okay, I will color differently vertical and horizontal, just to make clear the different roles they play. And then I just define another tensor as an element in the orbit. Okay, just take any other element in the orbit. And now let's see which things this imply. So we know that this imply that both T and S give the same state, the same people in every torus. But it's true that they also give the same state in every graph in which I somehow put many copies of the tensors and I join the legs with the only restriction that the arrows and the colors must be respected, meaning that an outgoing arrow should go into an ingoing arrow of any other tensor, and that I cannot mix red with blacks. Okay, that's, for instance, I have six tensors here. In the remaining vertical red legs, I put periodic boundary conditions, and I don't put them explicitly to avoid many, many crossing lines. And then I join the other legs as in the figure. So for instance, this is a valid graph. As you see, all outgoing arrows go into an ingoing arrow, and they respect the colors. It's clear, of course, that any Y or any C, any gauge, because of the way I define the graph, will vanish. Precisely the fact that I cannot mix colors means that Ys go with Ys and Cs go with Cs. And the fact that outgoing arrows go into ingoing arrows show that Y goes always to Y minus one and C goes to C minus one. So they cancel. So it's clear that they exactly give the same object, the same people. Okay, so both T and S define the same people, in this case, in this CD and NCD tensor six. Okay, so then this is a condition that if they are gauge related, they must fulfill. And the theorem is that this is an if and only if. It's a characterization if we consider all possible graphs respecting arrows and colors. And that's the theorem. So two tensors. I mean, the normal is a typo. Two arbitrary generic tensors, T and S, are gauge related. If and only if they define the same peppers for all graphs respecting arrows and colors. And of course, I mean, mathematically, these are just given by a pair of permutations. one which tells you how, in which order you are following the black lines and which order you are following the red lines. Moreover, it's enough to consider graphs with this number of vertices, e to the d squared log d, which sounds not so nice, except for the fact that it's almost optimal. So there are examples that require exponential of the vertices, okay? But again, don't be, usually in tensor networks, the bond dimension is considered fixed, okay? Because essentially in 2D and 3D, people cannot do large scaling with capital Ds because all algorithms scale polynomially with D, but with very large powers, D to the 13, D to the 12, things like that. So one can only work with small Ds. So essentially, even being exponential in capital D is not that crazy. But anyhow, it's close to optimal. Of course, we don't know if the right order is D squared, e to the D squared or e to the D, but essentially the exponential is needed. Okay, and again, the proof is standard GIT ideas. By Manford's theorem, we know that T and S are gauge related if and only if every invariant polynomial gives the same value. Next step is to show that invariant polynomials are generated by those induced by pair of permutations, exactly those considered in the theorem. And then we need to use bounds on the degree needed to generate the recurrent invariant polynomials. And then we estimate those bounds for the parameters of our problem. And that gives the theorem, or at least the theorem together with one. And to get two, we just cook up an example based on ideas related to tilings so that it works. Any questions so far? So before going into the last part, which okay will take me just 5 minutes, this machine learning application, I think there is a question I find interesting. Okay, maybe it's very vaguely formalized because the question is vague, but I think it's really, so this last theorem, I think opens a very interesting question, and that's the following. So for instance, in Norbert's talk, when he talked at the end of his last couple of slides, he was talking about this symmetry protected topological order in two dimensions. And the same is true for complex types of topological order in two dimensions. There are pairs of tensors. We generate the same PEPO, the same state, in a torus, but however, they are not gauge related. We know that generic tensors, normal tensors, do not have this property. And normal tensors correspond philosophically to the trivial phase when there is no topological order. And also easy topological orders are also gauge related. But when the topological order gets more complicated, then they are not. By the theorem, we have stated in the previous slide, there must be different graphs which can tell the difference. Even if they give the same PEPO for all torus, they cannot give the same PEPO for all graphs because otherwise they will be gauge related. So there must be one graph at least that distinguishes that gives different PEPOs for the two tensors. And then the question is, would it be super cool if there is any connection between the type of topological order present in the state, meaning excitations behave as non-abelian anions that have a representation of some whatever, fusion category, Wiegoff algebra, something, with the topology, the topology, mathematical word of topology, of the graph which separates T and S. So because usually when we talk about topological order, there are things which are topological, but a priori it's not clear which is the real connection with topology in the mathematical sense. Of course, there are many, but it would be nice if really this makes a clear connection between the topological content as quantum matter with the topology of a graph. Topology. But okay, maybe it's not true. There is nothing like that, but I think it's a centralizing question. And if true, I think it could set totally new light in this classification of phases problem for quantum matter. Okay, any questions so far before I move to the last thing? No? Okay. So let me finish then with a couple of slides about how these canonical form tensor and fundamental theorems are related indeed to privacy results in machine learning, and how this new result we showed opened the possibility to extend the results that so far we only showed in one dimension. So in this paper, the things I'm going to show that are in this archive paper are only in 1D, where already canonical forms existed. Now all this can happen in 2D and indeed in essentially any reasonable graph, because of course this minimal canonical form I explain everything for two dimensions so that I can work with the traditional invariant case. But indeed, this is pretty general, as one can, you could see from the talk of Michael. Okay. Okay, so which is the problem about privacy machine learning? Okay, sometimes machines are trained in sensitive data. For instance, COVID, okay, we start to forget about COVID, but okay, some years ago it was not a minor thing. So for instance, trying to find causes of higher death risk due to COVID. And now the nice thing is that there are huge databases related to COVID that one can play with. Okay, machines need to learn, of course, because they want to find a pattern. So the output function must have some information on the training data. That's, I mean, unavoidable. But it's desirable that that only the relevant information from the training data is kept in the output function. So in the sense that you don't learn other things that you don't need and that somehow are revealed afterwards. And let me just show you, I mean, just a trivial example. So imagine that we want to distinguish cats from dogs. And then our output function, I mean, the one that we learn, is just this polynomial that separates cats from dogs. And this other polynomial that separates cats from dogs, but both are the same polynomial, exactly the same polynomial. But what if, depending on the training set, we get this representation? I mean, T1 is the training set one. So if we train in training set one, we get this representation of the polynomial. And if we train in training set two, we get this representation of the polynomial. Even if both are equally good as a way to separate cats from dogs, we are getting information about which is the training set. Okay, so it's important not just to describe, I mean, a function, but it's important that the way we give the function, the way we give the parameters of the function, doesn't reveal extra information about the training set. Okay, this is a standard problem in cryptography, which is called obfuscation. And is what these patches of Microsoft are based on essentially. So you are given a patch to fix some bug in Microsoft Windows, and then essentially you don't want that. So you want that you can run the patch, but you don't want that by looking at the patch you learn other things about the operating system that allows you to reveal other vulnerabilities, no? So essentially, you would like to be able to run a system, but the description of the system should not reveal you any information of the way this circuit was obtained. Because of course, in order to design the patch, Windows, people working in Microsoft are using all the information they know about Windows, of course, but sometimes you shouldn't know. So essentially, that's the thing. So how to be able to run a program so that it doesn't reveal information so that the description of the program doesn't reveal information about how it was created. So essentially, the idea is that by looking at how the patch works, you should get no more information as if you see this as a black box in which you only have access to the input-output relation. That's the idea, I think. Okay, so is this a real threat in machine learning? If you do neural networks, yes. And then what we did is we took COVID databases, real ones, and apart from some parameters which are supposed to be maybe relevant, there is one parameter which is the parity of the day in which people enter the hospital that should be totally irrelevant for learning anything about COVID. And then we train neural networks to learn the probability of death based on the parameters, and then we got a nice prediction accuracy. But then what we did is we just trained in two different training sets, which were, I mean, taken totally at random from the database, except for the fact that we artificially biased the parity of the day entering the hospital. For instance, 80% of even parity, 20 of odd, and vice versa. And the attack was to learn such parity. So if in the training set there was more people that enter the hospital in an even or in an odd day. And we got very successful attacks, okay? Essentially linear with this percentage. So of course, in the black box input-output relation, you don't see that at all. So the information of this irrelevant variable is erased in the neural network, but the way in which it is erased reveals information about the training set. So essentially, you have access to all the parameters of neural networks. You can attack and you can learn. And essentially, the problem is that it's not clear which are the different choices of parameters that give approximately the same function. So these gate symmetries are not well understood or characterized in neural networks. However, in tensor networks, they are, because exactly we have fundamental theorems and canonical forms. So these gate symmetries are characterized. So we know when two tensor networks, when two matrix product states or matrix product operators, which is the input-output relation, is a matrix product operator, we know when two matrix product operators gives the same function. The only possibility is that they are gauge related. And now it's important that not only that we have a good characterization of the gauges, it's very important that we can also reduce the gauges to unitaries. Because then what we do is, if the gauges are just unitary matrices, we just can sample uniformly over them with the hard measure. And therefore, any information which is there is erased. Okay, it's like sampling uniformly the fiber that of all the descriptions that gives rise to the same function. And this way, exactly, all information which is in the white box description, which is not in the black box, is erased. And this gives rise to privacy. Okay, we did this with a 1D canonical form that already existed. And then if we take matrix product operators, matrix product states without the canonical form, we get the same vulnerability. But if we take the canonical form, suddenly all the attacks drop to essentially 50%. We have even better results than the one I plot here. But as I said, all this is done in 1D, because before that, now there was the only scenario in which a canonical form existed. But now with this minimal canonical form, we can extend this to any graph in principle. Whether this is useful in practice or not is still to be explored, but at least it opens the possibility of using that. And now that's the end. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks. Any questions?
So I'm wondering, so here your tensor networks, you always had the same tensor that you repeat multiple times, right? So also in your machine learning application, it was the case that you use such a system where you have this transmission.
Yes. No, it's a very good question, Omar. Thank you. No, I mean, of course, I made the whole talk for the translational invariant case, but the minimal canonical form you can also construct without the translational invariant case. The things done now, you have one action of GL per or SL per leg, and then the group is larger, but this is polynomial. And because the arguments of this GIT are so general, I mean, as in the Michal's talk, they apply to essentially any scenario, in particular also there. This is not written in the current version of the, I think not FREC, in the current version of the draft, the non-traditional invariant case, but okay, I mean, it's just because we wanted to submit it to QIP and we didn't have enough time, but essentially, I mean, yeah, we'll add it at some point, yes.
I have a question for the in the 1D case, if I remember correctly, like the canonical form for them is this here if you have not periodic boundary condition, right? Like pure boundary condition, or is it? I was wondering whether the difficulty of getting the canonical form depends on whether you have these periodic boundary conditions or not.
So, sorry, there is quite a lot of noise. Can you? I mean, so you mean that?
So I mean. Yeah. For the 1D case, I think the canonical form is easy when we have open boundary condition, but it gets tricky because of the cycle when we get the tracks, right? When you get the periodic boundary condition. So for the 2D, is it the same thing? Like the main difficulty comes from the fact that you trace out that you have periodic boundary condition, or was it also an open kind of problem to find these canonical forms, even with what we call open boundary conditions?
I mean, in principle, it should work equally with open boundary conditions, even with different tensors. There are many difficulties coming from other things. For instance, as I said, deciding whether two tensors, two tensors give rise to, or families of tensors give rise to the same PEPs, and showing that this is the only, this is characterized exactly by being gauge related. This is something which is in general not true. And it's only true if you allow for generic tensors like these normal tensors. And for instance, which is the characterization of that for the case in which if the tensors are all equal at these two permutations, I mean these graphs respecting arrows and colors, of course there is an analogous one just following the same proof for the non-traditional invariant case, but it's so far not very satisfactory for us. It's too cumbersome. So of course this can become very complex. But once you know that all you have is this gauge freedom, fixing the gauge is just general GIT results. And then this is okay. Gradient in the end, some sort of gradient descent. Okay.
And I had another question, maybe about because the canonical form in 1D, some application or some of this canonical form, it makes computation more efficient, right? So, like if you have this orthogonality condition, you can, for example, marginalize very easily or compute the norm of the you can do a lot of things very easily. So, it is also the case here, because I understand that the main goal is to get this canonical form, for example, to do identity testing, but is it also that you get more efficient algorithm when you want, for example, to trace out part of your system or things like
yes.
that?
Yes, no, that's a super good question. One of the nice things of the canonical form in 1D is that it allows to make very fast contractions of the tensor. In 2D, no, and indeed it cannot be because we know that contracting a PEPS is hard. I mean, it's at least it's PP hard. In particular, MP hard. So, essentially, I mean, there cannot exist because we work for arbitrary tensors. So it cannot exist. It cannot exist any magic way to contract all tensors. So this is one of the things that our 2D canonical form doesn't add with respect to the 1D. So we hope that at least the stability of the algorithms it will add, but this is work in progress. But no, for this contraction, it doesn't help. So, I mean, the things are as complex as before, of course.
Concerning a possible connection to the policy, it looked to me like the graphs that you use to construct the PEPOS, where you can plug in the tensors. Those consist of a bunch of disjoint loops coming in two colors, right, and only separate colors intersect. And this looks like the same, or almost the same thing, like a Hilbert diagram of a three manifold. I've definitely thought about this. Is it the same thing?
It's a very good question. I don't know. Michael, Freck, any help?
Very, very nice suggestion. We should look into it. I don't know. I think once in my life I knew what these diagrams were, but when I was a proper apologist, but yeah. No, that's very curious, actually. This was for three manifolds, right? And then the permutations tell you like how. Yeah, I forget how it goes. Yeah, like some handle body gluing stuff, right?
Good. All right. Thanks again.